of millions of voices. One man will become many.
We are not alone out here.
Listen to my story.
I have a bad feeling about this.
What?
Oh, great Scott!
No need to panic.
Very Captain. Funny.
Jack Sparrow.
Just your friendly neighborhood Spider-Man.
We get it, blah, blah, blah.
Get ready for an adventure unlike any you've ever seen.
What is that?
Or heard.
My delicate ears can't take it no more.
Prepare yourself for laughter.
Tears.
And moments of neither. Get set for the voice to end all voices. The master of mouth. The king of characterization. The prince of pronunciation. The infinite impersonator. The architect of audibles. The noun of nouns. The one, the only. Is anybody buying this yet? Ladies and gentlemen, the best of the best. Please help me welcome to the stage every voice you've heard and will hear, including this one, is... James Arnold Taylor!
Yeah. Oh, thank you. Oh, come on. Curtain was open there, huh? So you saw that. That's awkward. Okay, well, welcome to the show. Thank you so much. Now, my name is James Arnold Taylor. Most of you probably know me as the voice of Obi-Wan Kenobi on Star Wars The Clone Wars. But, you know, I gotta tell you, my career as a voice actor began a long time ago in a studio far, far away before the Force brought Obi-Wan and I together. But, you know, what is a voice actor? Well, basically, someone who spends their time in a little padded room talking to themselves. And in my career, I've done an awful lot of that. But see, I love to perform, and at times I've had to overcome a lot of things to do it. But I feel that your dreams are always worth pursuing, and I hope to encourage you today to pursue yours by telling you a little bit about mine. And since it's Star Wars weekends, I thought I'd get a hand from my alter ego. So, help me, Obi-Wan Kenobi. You're my only hope.
Yes, James, I'm here. Well, I see you have some friends. Welcome, everyone, to Star Wars Weekends. I should be checking in throughout the show to see how you're feeling, James, so do be mindful.
Oh, of the Force?
No, of the time. Move along.
Move along. Move along. Move along. How does he do that? Okay, well, for me, it was always about voices and sounds. I could spend hours as a kid pretending to be different people in different places, and it was the theater of the mind. It was my escape from the troubles around me, and it was the best playground I could find. Now, what taught me about voices at first was tapes of old radio plays. See, I would study these and listen to them. I mean, they were great. Well, let me put it this way.
The 1930s to the 1950s were known as the golden age of radio. Radio was the forerunner for all entertainment today. Before you could watch television, you had to listen to radio.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. WJAT Radio brings you all the entertainment that's fit to voice. Yes, radio is comedy.
We have who's on first, what's on second, I don't know who's on third.
So who's playing first?
Yes.
I mean the fellow's name.
Who?
The fella playing first base.
Who is on first?
Well, what are you asking me for?
Say the secret word, win $100.
Well, now, really.
Good night, Mrs. Calabash, wherever you are. Ha-cha-cha-cha-cha.
Drama.
I love you, Margot.
And I love you, Chad, but...
There's someone else, isn't there?
No, Chad.
No? Then why don't you tell me who this is?
Hello, Margot.
Sports! The champ is looking to be in bad shape. The challenge has got him on the ropes. He's giving him a left, and a right, and a left, and a right, and still another left, and another right.
Music.
Baby, as sweet
sweet as sweet can be, like sugar from a candy tree, honey kisses from the vine. News!
Dateline, Europe, 1945. The German High Command surrender their forces to the Allies. Hitler's minions have given up the fight.
And suspense! I'm telling you, whatever you do, do not open that door.
But I must see.
Trust me, nothing can prepare you for what is on the other side.
But I must,
Hello, Margot.
Yes, the world of entertainment at your fingertips through the miracle of radio.
So, now, the other thing that taught me about voices was animation, or cartoons, as we called it back then. As a kid in grade school, I would sit at my desk and recreate scenes of my favorite cartoons for my classmates. Now, see, this was before the internet and YouTube, DVDs, DVRs. VCRs were brand new back then, and they cost like $1 million. So, basically, I was TiVo.
Yet, mouse.
Oh, gee, Mr. Sheriff. We'll pay it. Right, Goofy?
Right, Mickey.
Right, Donald? Donald?
Yes, he can never actually talk like Donald, but I could sneeze like him. As I got older, I still recreated scenes, but now from my favorite movies.
Too bad the Hovitos don't know you the way I do, Belloc.
Yes, too bad. You could warn them if only you spoke Hovitos. Hakanda Matusu, Hovota!
Your powers are weak, old man.
You can't win, Dolph. If you strike me down, I shall become more powerful than you can possibly imagine.
Whoa, whoa, wait a second, Doc. Are you telling me that you built a time machine? Out of a DeLorean?
The way I see it, if you're gonna build a time machine into a car, why not do it with some style? Besides, the stainless steel construction made the fluxes for... Look out!
Oh, this is heavy. So soon I took all this talking to myself to the stage. At the age of 16, I wrote an act and became a stand-up comic. At 17, I got a job at a radio station cleaning up. The pay was consistent. There wasn't any. That is, until one night when the overnight DJ didn't show up. It was like out of a movie. The boss asked me to fill in. See, for months, I'd been watching the DJs, studying how they worked the microphones and the equipment, and at night, I would go into the production room and do my own fake shows and commercials. So, they decided to give me a shot at it. From there, I was on my way. By the age of 21, I moved to Hollywood and syndicated radio, where I wrote, voiced, and produced thousands of comedy bits for radio stations all over the country. It was fantastic. I was making a living with my voice. I loved radio, but I knew what I really wanted to do was be a voice actor. So I put a demo together, and after a few years of persistence, I got an agent. You know, some of my first voiceover work is playing right here at Disney World's Animal Kingdom ride, Dinosaur. Some of my first big animation work was for Disney as well, voice doubling Michael J. Fox in Atlantis: The Lost Empire. I even got to take over for Michael in the sequel, Atlantis: Milo's Return, which is now available on Disney DVD. You know, it wasn't all overnight. I mean, being a voice actor is a lot of hard work, and you go through a lot of auditioning. And in an audition, they may ask you to do 20, 30 different things, and you never know what to expect.
Okay, James, get yourself comfortable. We want you to sound very real, casual, conversational. We're looking to get you to read this in about 1.7 seconds. So don't give it too much emphasis, and make sure it's not too announcery, okay?
Okay.
Okay, well, we're rolling here on take one, whenever you're ready.
Use only as directed.
Great. Okay, let's try one a little more conversational.
Use only as directed.
Now more serious.
Use only as directed.
But with a bit of a smile.
Use only as directed.
But also with concern.
Use only as directed.
Maybe more quizzical.
Use only as directed.
What if we needed it in 3.8 seconds instead of 1.7?
Use only as directed.
Okay, now stretch it out, but go back to 1.7 seconds.
Use only as directed.
How about with a German accent?
Use only as directed.
No. New York, maybe?
Use only as directed.
British?
Use only as directed.
More Cockney.
Use only as directed.
How about French?
Use only as directed.
Romanian.
Directed, use only as.
What did a woman sound like?
A woman?
Use only as directed.
Whispering.
Use only as directed.
Yeah, more staccato.
Use only as directed.
Pianissimo?
Wouldn't that kind of be like whispered?
What's that?
Nothing. Use only as directed.
Now that sounded like whispered. Can you give us just a regular announcer?
Use only as directed.
Now energize it.
Use only as directed.
Bigger.
Use only as directed.
Bigger and faster.
Use only as directed.
Faster and bigger.
Use only as directed.
Bigger.
Use only as directed.
Okay, stand by. All right, James, we got it. We're actually gonna go with, let's see. Oh yeah, the first take we did. Hey, thanks so much for coming in.
All right. Now you know why it's a padded room.
Well done, James. No doubt all that experience prepared you for your greatest voice challenge.
Oh, Fred Flintstone? Yeah, you know.
No.
Johnny Test?
No. I was referring to a certain Jedi.
Oh, duh, yeah. Plo Koon, of course.
Between you and Anakin, why do I bother?
Oh, I don't know about you, but I love Plo Koon. Now, a great honor for me is I'm the first person to give him a voice. Even greater honor is director Dave Filoni on The Clone Wars. Well, this is his favorite character. The direction Dave gave me when coming up with the voice was one word, Gandalf. See, he wanted that Ian McKellen sound, and with a voice like that, it's hard to not sound important, you know? In fact, it's said that a great thespian could sound dramatic or exciting or compelling, reading from, like, stereo instructions to, say, the phone book.
Smith. John. 316. Willowbrook Lane. 5 5 4 2 3 1. Stereo speaker installation. Waltz connecting the left and right speaker interfaces. One must be certain to make the connections properly. For if the cords are not firmly plugged in, no sound shall pass!
So for Plo, I give it my best.
Ian McKellen.
And then sound design genius Matthew Wood gives it his best, and with a bit of
pitching and processing, a Jedi Master's voice is born.
You know, it was always my dream to be at least one famous cartoon character, but I gotta tell you, I never knew I'd be able to turn on the TV.
Hey guys, sorry we're late.
And here.
Next, animation domination continues with
me.
Hey Lindsay, I miss my friend.
Doing so many voices.
Oh, Bonnie!
Or play video games with my voice in them. How cool.
It is time for you to take up command and help us turn the tide.
You know, on Clone Wars alone, besides Obi-Wan and Plo Koon, I get to be so many different characters. And in the clip you're about to see, every single voice you hear is me. And if I've done my job right, you may have never known it. Enjoy.
We can do this the difficult way or the simple way. The choice is yours.
Hey, what's this? What are you reaching for?
Stand down!
You can't take us all, Jedi.
Would you like to try and prove your theory?
Start the machine. Time for the Jedi to meet with his fatal accident.
Can I help you?
May I help you?
Yes, what seems to be the problem?
This one was faster than most. I've lost the scent.
These are Trandoshans. They're going to release us and hunt us down for sport.
Try and keep up, clone.
You're looking a little too young to be a Jedi. Oh, yeah,
A thousand apologies, young one.
With regret, I report that my fleet will no longer be able to provide protection for the troops on Ryloth.
Senator Tucci, you are given the authority to negotiate a peaceful settlement between the sovereign planet of Pantora and the Tals.
It is decided, then.
Welcome back.
I must say, you're not at all what I pictured. Someone with such a soft voice.
Take them to interrogation. Torture them slowly.
Oh well, just another boring day saving the universe.
May the Force be with you.
Yeah. Just me in a little padded room, talking to myself. Yeah, see, this is how actors that spend their time in front of the camera can sometimes feel about voice acting. A little crazy and kind of restricted. And I got out of this in rehearsal. Let me see if I can... Nothing. Okay, never mind. So, see, when you're doing voice acting, you can't rely on those good looks to get all that acting out. You have to rely on your vocal cords. And you can have no inhibitions. Now, what I mean is, you can't worry about making a funny face or sounding strange. You know? For me, the show that really puts this to the test as a voice actor is Johnny Test. On the show, I play 11-year-old Johnny, whose genius twin sisters use as their test subject. You get it? See what I did there with the test? Okay. It's great fun to be Johnny, but it does require some vocal acrobatics. I mean, all of which I have to do right in front of this microphone without a lot of movement, even if I get turned into a fish and beat up by an angry dolphin. Yeah, I can't move. But, you know, actually for me, I don't feel restricted by it all. It's kind of like the voices set me free from it. They make me feel like this, free from the chains of the vocal booth and the microphone. So I can voice Johnny and many other characters on the show without restrictions.
Imagine a voiceover that could actually turn a boring old day into an exciting movie. Stand back, citizens, for this looks like a job for Johnny X.
Johnny X, I, Dark Vegan, will destroy you.
Man, is it hard to breathe with this thing on. And you'll need some help from me, Mr. Mittens.
And me, the beekeeper.
Help!
Pork Belly is under attack by bad guys. But who are they, super evil villains, and where in the world is Johnny X to save us? More on that after a word from our sponsor.
I'm Doc Beeble. Try my piles of honey bar.
So are you guys gonna, like, take over the universe or the world or something?
Don't know yet. We're kicking around some ideas.
Ooh, I like Johnny's suggestion of taking over the world. Anyone else taking over the world?
You know, on second thought, let's just leave all the voice acting to James Arnold Taylor, huh?
There's no voice can contain you, James. Well done. I do find it hard to believe that voice comes from the same throat as mine, but...
It's really true, and it's really awesome.
Oh, my. I just see a medical droid about this. Carry on, James.
Okay, Master Obi-Wan. Sorry, buddy. All right, I hope he's okay. You know, it's a bummer he left, though. I was just about to share how he and I came together. You know, back in 2002, when I auditioned for the micro series of The Clone Wars, I had no idea what I was reading for.
I was stunned and humbled to find that I would be voicing him in a Star Wars cartoon. I mean, this was my two favorite things coming together. But the problem with the micro series was exactly that. It was micro. I mean, at 3 minutes each, I might come in and say three or four lines of dialogue in an episode, most of which were usually, Anakin, Anakin, Anakin! So the best part about it was I got to voice him in other things, like the Revenge of the Sith video game, which was being made at the same time as the movie. So I got to see a lot of the movie as it was all being made, which was very cool. One thing that I was asked to do at the time, though, was to match Ewan McGregor's voice as closely as I could. And I remember recreating a scene for the game that was from the film that really locked me in as his double for the folks at Lucas. I remember watching the scene over and over again. It got to the point where I could do it with the sound turned down, and it's one of my favorite scenes. It's a little something like this.
You were the chosen one! It was said that you would destroy the Sith, not join them! Bring balance to the Force, not leave it in darkness! You were my brother, Anakin. I loved you.
So now, whenever the Jedi Master is called to have a voice, I do my best to pay proper tribute and homage to both the amazing Sir Alec Guinness.
These aren't the droids you're looking for.
And the fantastic Ewan McGregor.
I have a bad feeling about this.
I mentioned that my work as Obi-Wan Kenobi started as a voice double for Ewan McGregor, and so much of my work as a voice actor is doubling celebrities when they're not available. And through all my years of working on some of the biggest movie franchises with some of the biggest stars, I've come to find we all come from the same place. Now, what I mean by that is all voices are tones, and basically you can get from one tone to the next by, you know, adding some depth or giving it a little texture, raising the pitch or giving it an accent. Let me give you an example. Let's just start with my regular voice. Hang on, my regular voice. Well, okay, so anyway, so if we start somewhere around here and change just small aspects of my voice, we'll find that my voice is very similar to a lot of different celebrities. One that I recently discovered that I love is Michael Emerson from Lost. You remember he played Benjamin Linus, and, well, he had such a way of talking that everything he said sounded a little creepy and just a little off. Now, if we take the creep factor out and round it off and make it a little more folksy, you get Ron Howard. If you lose the folk and give it some soul, you get Justin Timberlake. Now it's becoming like a social network of voices. Use some wizardry in a British accent, you get Daniel Radcliffe.
Lay it back, give it a little twang, you get yourself Matthew McConaughey. Shift it over just a little and you get Christian Slater, who if you drop down in tone is Jack Nicholson. Raise it back up and seem less interested and you get David Spade. And you are,
oh, I'm McLovin, and I totally sound just like, whoa, wait a second, Doc, this is heavy, it's me again. So let's drop it down in tone and you get Shia LaBeouf. Whoa, wait a second, Optimus, you mean to tell me my car is a robot?
Oh, this is like, you know, unbelievable. I gotta go tell Sandy, because it's crazy the way these voices intertwine. The way I break up my sentence structure is not that dissimilar to a smarter than the average bear.
Hey, Ruffy boy, Ruffy boy. Hey, Fred, there, you know there, Sammy. To properly connect the voices there, you just gotta shiny, 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 shiny. Gunga, the Gunga, Gunga, the Gunga. You talking to me?
Huh?
You talking to me, Gunga, the Gunga? Well, if I'm curt with you, I'm sorry. It's just, I love you, Spartacus.
Oh, Yogi, those all sound the same. I'm going to tell Mr. Ranger and he'll make them off like a can of fish. Oh, yeah, like a can of spinach.
Well, blow me down and hoo-ha, you know what I mean? You ever notice Al Pacino slowly turning into Jim Ignatowski from Taxi? Okay. I mean, great Scott, there's a direct correlation between voices. This is temporal experiment number one. If you take Dr. Emmett Brown and teach him karate, you get Hong Kong Fui, number one super guy.
Give him a British accent and you get John Hurt. Take away the accent and bring it down to almost a whisper. And it's Jack Palance.
Actually, I think it's Eastwood, punk.
Will, go ahead, make my voice.
Well, that depends on your definition of the word voice, because if you give mine a surfer twang,
You get Nicolas Cage, who always seems to start a sentence here, but by the end, he's really hot and way up here. You know, he's kind of like Frank Caliendo doing John Madden.
Or Dana Carvey doing Regis Philbin. He's out of control.
I'm not going to do Dana Carvey doing George Bush with me pruning. I'm going to do Dana Carvey doing Johnny Carson. Of course, if I want to do the real Johnny Carson, well, then I need to drop my voice down in tone to right about there, right? Hi-o, or is it actually, yeah, mate. Right, it's not Johnny Carson laugh. No, it's Johnny Depp, who sometimes, oh, a chocolatier. Or, oh, this is making me madder than a hatter, Alice.
Oh, that's funny with the madder and the hatter and the,
whoa, funny how? Funny like a clown, like I'm here to amuse you, huh? Because I'm not a clown, I'm a chicken hawk and you're my chicken.
No, boy, I say you got it all wrong, son. I'm not a chicken, I'm a therapist, boy. And what you need is a checkup from the neck up, because it's an inconvenient truth. That life is like a box of chocolates.
I like the ones with the peanut, yeah.
Wah-ha-ha-hee-yo, ooh, that's how it starts. And then there's running and screaming. And
it's like me in a relationship. It's a knowing situation. You know what I mean? Yeah, I know exactly what you mean, because I sound like you, you sound like me. If we move our voices sideways, you get Paul Giamatti. Or is it Paul Reiser? You know what I mean? But the whole question really is, who are these people?
Zoinks, like, hey, Scoob. All these crazy voices like blend together.
Well, it's tricky. Tricky it is, yes. Near and far. Right, Ricky, did you say tricky? Because I gotta tell you, I got no respect at all. Oh, but if I did, that'd be great, Gazoo. Yeah, but damn, but don't do.
Oh, Mary. Oh, man. Oh, Shazbot. No.
Spot. Scotty. Zulu. Judy.
Jane, get me off this crazy thing. Heavens to Murgatroyd, exit stage left, even.
Hummina. Nya. Meow.
Blah.
Ah.
Oh.
All righty then, the ring it around town. Okay. Oh, you know, as a matter of fact, we got a great show for you tonight, but that's all the time we have, so even that's all, folks.
Well, now, Lucas. However, I think it wise to wrap it up and end on this high note. You know, spending time with you, James, has made time with Anakin seem almost dull. Oh, it appears my transmission is breaking up. Enjoy the rest of Star Wars weekends, everyone, and may the Force be with you. Always.
Okay, hey, thanks, Master Kenobi. May the Force be with you as well.
Boy, that's going to be some long distance, Bill. Sorry, Disney. You guys are out there. Okay, well, I can't thank you all enough. What a great time we've had here tonight, right?
And you know, in well over 2.5 decades, I've been able to be very blessed to be some pretty iconic characters. And I got to tell you, the main thing for me is, it's not just so much about doing the voices, but it's about performing. That's been my lifelong goal, and it's my dream since I was 4 years old. But I really wanted to show you how one person can not only just be so many people, but they can affect so many people if they stick to their dream. And the point for you is, I know that each and every person in this room has a dream. And sometimes those dreams get squashed. Sometimes we get caught up in life, family, friends, emergencies, things like that. But you all have a dream inside you, every single one of you. And it doesn't have to be being a big star. It could be being the best dad or the best mom or the best kid you can be. But whatever it is, I'd ask a favor of you. Write it down. Look at it. Look at it often. And see if it's a good dream, a pure dream, one that helps other people. And pursue it. Pursue it with all your heart. It's not always going to be easy, and people are going to tell you can't do it at times, but you can do it, okay? You can do it. About 6.5 years ago for me, I hit a wall. I woke up, and I had no voice. See, I had bought a house with my wife, because we were about to adopt our little girl, and that house had toxic mold, and I was the one that found it, and I got exposed to it, and I dropped down to about 97 pounds. Then the other thing that happened to me was, I lost my voice.
And the doctor told me there was a good chance that voice wasn't going to come back to its full potential. Well, this was not part of my dream. This was not part of my plan. But I had to deal with it. I had to persevere. I had to have faith, which I do. And I had to go after that dream harder than I ever had to before. But if I didn't, and if I gave up or squashed the dream, I wouldn't be up here right now doing all these fun voices for you. And that charming fellow right there wouldn't have this voice right here, and that would make me very sad. So whatever you have that you've been holding back, don't do it anymore. Get your friends to encourage you. Encourage your friends. Encourage your family. There's a dream inside each one of us, and we can get it. You know, I was always the smallest kid in my class, and I never knew I would grow up one day to be
the biggest caveman around, or
two of the coolest Jedi Knights. So pursue those dreams, and remember, you heard a lot of different people here today, right? But truly, it was all just
one man, one throat, many voices. You have been witness to the vocal daredevil, the magician of mimicry, the little guy with a big voice in a little padded room.
Talking to myself. Thank you so much. God bless you.